My patient, Mr. X, a 40-year-old gentleman from Chambal district in Uttar Pradesh and a laborer by profession, presented to Safdarjung Hospital with chief complaints of pain abdomen since the last 9 months, a lump in the left lower abdomen since the last 9 months, per-rectal bleeding since 6 months, and non-passage of flatus and stools since the last 5 days. The patient was apparently well 9 months back when he developed pain abdomen in left lower abdomen, which was insidious in onset, colicky in nature, and moderate in intensity. It was relieved on passing stools. There were no aggravating factors. There were no radiations. The patient became aware of an abdominal lump in the left lower abdomen when pointed out by a local physician. It was initially of size 5x5 cm, but it gradually increased to its current size. The patient has been experiencing episodic bleeding per rectum for the last 6 months. The patient has been having these episodes for 1 to 2 days, and such episodes have been 1 to 2 per month. There has been fresh blood in stools, sometimes blood mixed with stools. There's also been passage of mucus per rectally with stools. Since the last 5 days, patient has complained of non-passage of flatus and stools along with abdominal distension. The pain abdomen has increased in frequency and intensity and has been present over the abdomen diffusely. There have been 2 episodes of yellow-colored vomitus. There's a history of significant weight loss, history of loss of appetite, history of constipation which is increasing. There is no history of any other swelling over the body, no history of blood in urine, no history suggestive of metastasis, no history of any chronic medical illness or TB contact, patient takes mixed diet, and there is a history of red meat intake present, non-smoker, non-alcoholic, and bowel habits are altered as explained. There is no documented family history of any GI, gynecological, or urological cancers, though the patient has given history of a younger sister who died at the age of 35 years, having similar complaints of pain abdomen and an abdominal lump. Summary, my patient, a 40-year-old male presenting with complaints of pain abdomen and left lower abdominal lump, which is increasing in size for the last 9 months, per rectal bleeding for the last 6 months, associated with spurious diarrhea and increasing constipation, along with symptoms of intestinal obstruction for the last 5 days, with possibly a positive family history of cancer-related death.
You said the patient has got colicky pain abdomen. Could you describe the colic? You have not told us the duration of colic and the interval between the colics.
Well, the patient was having sudden onshoots, and around initially the colic pain were around 15 minutes apart. But as the
duration of colic?
Ma'am, around 10 to 12 seconds.
Yeah. So what is the importance of knowing the duration of colic?
Ma'am, it tells how long is the smooth muscle contracting against the obstruction.
So which are those colics which last for only a few seconds? What are the colics that may last for, say, a few hours? And what are those colics which may have a circadian rhythm? So it's usually intestinal colics which would last for a few seconds and maybe very severe and cramp-like. No. Right? And a few hours, maybe biliary colic.
Biliary colic,
right?
Yes.
Uretric colic again would be very severe and may last from... The interval may, you know, the duration may be longer than that of an intestinal colic. What is tenesmus?
And tenesmus is per-rectal irritation and itching.
Is it?
And
tenesmus.
Per-rectal itching.
See, you said history of passage of mucus, and there is history of per-rectal bleeding also.
Ma'am.
So you must know what tenesmus is.
Ma'am, it is a per-rectal itching and the feeling of incomplete defecation, which is brought about by.
No, that's not tenesmus. It's again, yes. Who will define tenesmus? Yes, Sukriti? No, that's not tenesmus.
Painful act of defecation without any evacuation of mucus.
And relieved by passage of blood and mucus.
Mucus is what you pass at the end.
This is a classical history of passage of mucus in this. So what do you think, if you get this history from a patient, the patient is passing mucus per rectum, what are the things that come to your mind?
Ma'am,
pathologies?
Any lump, any obstruction in the left lower abdomen, in the left colon, and because...
The passage of mucus, first thing that comes to your mind is obstruction?
Ma'am, any lump because the mucus...
Suppose there is no lump, mucus cannot come?
So it can come if there is an increased secretion, increased GI secretions, ma'am. And
all GI,
increased
GI means?
Secretions
you mean to say diarrhea will cause mucus?
No, ma'am.
So you have to be clear. Right, that means one, the pathology is colonic because mucus secreting cells are present there, right? And then non-surgical pathologies like dysenteries will cause mucus, and surgical pathologies involving the colon will cause passage of mucus. Now, what is it? What are the things that come to your mind when you talk about bleeding per rectum? What are the things that you would want to define? You said there is bleeding per rectum. How much was the amount?
Yes,
you said it is red in color. That's all you talked about it.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, the bleeding was red in color.
What is the thing that you would want to rationalize in your mind?
How much amount
is it coming in? And is it coming before the stool, mixed with the stool, or after the stool as a red streak? These are things that I have to clean. If there is any associated presence of any mucus clots.
So what is in your mind when you want to clarify all these things?
Ma'am, a freshly coming blood can have a origin in the left colon, while a black color blood, altered.
So what
blood
we want to know is that whether the bleeding is occurring from the anorectal area or from higher up.
Yes, ma'am.
And that, are we dealing with a malignant pathology, or are we dealing with a benign pathology,
yes,
like anal fissure? And now you tell us the difference between all these now.
I mean, case
we'll have to move on. You'll tell at the end so that you made a presentation.
Yeah,
but quickly, anal fissure, hemorrhoid, and the malignancy.
In hemorrhoid, a blood comes in the form of a red streak over the stool.
You finish first, we'll not stop you. Okay. You just finish. Okay.
Hemorrhoid, it doesn't come
just
like a red
on.
Streak.
You carry on.
Hemorrhoid, ma'am, it is a flash of...
Can you finish with it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Flash in the pen in case of hemorrhoid, and blood, fresh blood in case of a left colonic growth.
Which of these causes painful defecation?
Sir, fissure.
Why?
Sir, because there is a mucosal break, and on...
The mucosal break causes pain?
And tightening of the sphincter.
Why is it painful? Where is fissure located? The answer is below the dentate line. And hemorrhoids are above the dentate line. So, it will be painful,
yes,
defecation, pain, bleeding. And hemorrhoids, until they are dragged down...
They won't pain, sir.
They won't pain.
Because they're above the dentate
line. So, it's a painless bleeding. How about malignancy?
So, malignancy won't pain, sir.
Maybe or may not be.
Yes, sir.
So, you can't say. It's a different kind of a pain. You may get tenesmus there also.
Sir, yes, sir.
You may get tenesmus in any inflammatory disorder of the large bowel also. And as rightly said, mucus is produced by the large bowel. That's
colonic,
exactly where. Yes.
Colonic
so,
mucosa, yes,
so, blood with mucus, probably you're thinking in terms of rectal
colonic.
Or sigmoidorectal. Frank bleeding, bright red. You may still think in terms of left-sided colonic malignancies which are bleeding. Maroon-colored blood and passage of clots, you have to keep right-sided malignancies.
Yes, proximal, yes, proximal.
Start, carry on with the examination now. You said possibly. Can you go back? Possibly.
Sir.
A positive family history of...
cancer-related death.
Was not clear.
Sir, the patient did tell that his sister had an abdominal lump along with abdominal pain and died at an early age. But he was not sure.
So
what
you're
it was.
Not sure about,
yes,
it.
There was no
and
documentation.
You mentioned spurious diarrhea.
Sir.
What exactly is spurious diarrhea?
So spurious diarrhea is patient is actually taking increased dosage of laxatives to relieve his constipation, because of which he is passing, defecating more often, but stool is not being
That's
passed.
Not correct. What is spurious diarrhea? There is a left-sided growths are stenosing, no?
Yes, sir.
So what collects above them is fecal matter, which by staying there gets dried off. I mean, things keep on pooling in, and it stays there. And patient is not able to pass it because water keeps getting absorbed. What subsequently happens is bacteria act. It gets liquefied, mucus mixed, liquefied stools pass through that. Patient thinks he has passed stools, but this
bacteria
is, I think,
is
a Bailey and Love stuff, what I was asking. This should have been answered. And you might have heard it a million times. So
no fecal matter is passed.
So you should know when you write spurious diarrhea. So it's a false diarrhea.
Yes.
Which is because of, not because of any diarrhea related, those kind of things. It is narrowing and proximal collection, which is acted upon by bacteria, and then mucus and the liquid stool all mixed with whatever starts coming through that narrow opening.
Sir.
Okay. Chalo. Let's move.
I examined my patient in broad daylight after taking due consent, standing on the right side. Patient's vitals, patient was afebrile. Pulse rate was 80 per minute, regular in rhythm, normal in volume, normal in character, good in volume. All the peripheral pulses were palpable. Vessel wall was not palpable. There was no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. Respiration was abdominothoracic and 14 at a rate of 14 per minute. blood pressure was measured in the right arm, and it was 114 by 80 millimeter per mercury. Patient weighs 48 kilograms, stands 167 centimeter tall. His BMI is 17.3, which makes him underweight. Patient is conscious, oriented to time, place, and person, and alert. He's lying in the right lateral decubitus. Patient is of average build. He's poorly nourished on account of having pallor, pitting edema, and of a low BMI. Here is the picture of the pitting edema. There was no icterus, no cyanosis, no generalized lymphadenopathy. Patient's performance status is KPS 60. On abdominal examination, on inspection, we can see generalized distension is present. Umbilicus is transversely stretched. There's visible fullness in left iliac fossa. All the abdominal quadrants are moving equally with respiration. There are no scars, sinuses, fistula, or striae on the skin. The hernial sites are free, and there is external genitalia is normal, no renal angle fullness. There is a lump that you can see, and the umbilicus is transversely stretched. This is the caudal end, cranial end, this is the caudal end. On palpation, a lump of size 11 cross 7 centimeter was palpable in the left iliac fossa extending into the hypogastrium. The lump is mobile, non-tender, having nodular surface, hard consistency, and well-defined margins. There's a gurgling sound that is present on pressing the lump, and there's a dull note on percussion. Abdomen is soft, non-tender, there's no guarding or rigidity. Liver, spleen, and kidney are not palpable. There are no other palpable lumps. Free fluid is present, bowel sounds are exaggerated, and the palpable supraclavicular lymph node is present. As you can see, I have marked it here in the picture.
Again, we discussed it yesterday, I think you were missing. Is it supraclavicular lymph node?
It's a clean node, sir.
So say that, sir. It's a workhouse node that is present. You can actually see it, I agree with you. This is not supraclavicular. If you go further backwards, that is supraclavicular region.
Sir. Yeah. On per-rectal examination, there were no growth, no blood tinge, there was no deposits in the cul-de-sac. Mucus and fecal swelling were present. Systemic examination was normal. My summary is that a 40-year-old gentleman.
Cul-de-sac?
It's a pouch of Douglas.
You see pouch of Douglas in males also? This is a male patient, no?
Yes, sir.
There is no pouch of Douglas there. They have rectovesical pouch. Okay? Pouch of Douglas is in females.
Yes, sir.
All
right. A 40-year-old gentleman with generalized abdominal distension and a hard, mobile, intra-abdominal lump in the left iliac fossa, extending into hypogastrium, measuring 11 cross 7 centimeter, with a gurgling sound on pressing with free fluid in the abdomen, and a palpable scalene lymph node. Clinically, a sigmoid colon lump, probably malignant, with acute intestinal obstruction with no pressure effects. Most probably a sigmoid colon carcinoma.
Before we discuss it, you've got some more findings which you described to us, but you're not mentioning here. There's a workhouse note that is positive.
Yes, sir. Scalene.
So in the diagnosis, will it reflect somewhere?
Yes, sir. It is probably suggestive of a metastatic etiology.
Maybe that could have been added.
Sir.
We need to, whenever we are talking about a malignancy, we need to mention about the stage mostly.
Sir.
This looks like metastatic cancer.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Ratna, now you can ask.
So, can we go back to the examination of abdomen on your slides? So, what do you think is this hard lump? Can we go back to the image only? Yeah.
Ma'am.
Is this 10 centimeter big thing? What do you think is this lump?
Ma'am, I think
you described the size of the lump.
Yes, ma'am.
You told us that it's hard in consistency.
Yes, ma'am.
But then you said that on pressing, you hear gurgling sounds.
Yes, ma'am.
So a hard lump with a gurgling sound, what do you think is this hard lump? You mean to say the whole lump? What is the surface of this lump? Is it a smooth, hard lump? Is it a nodular lump? What
is it? It's a nodular lump with well-defined margins, and it's mobile.
Did we describe it as nodular anywhere?
Yes, ma'am. Here.
Where? Oh, yes, I missed it. Yes. Yeah. Now you tell us, what is this lump? What do you think is this hard nodular lump? You think the whole thing is a sigmoid growth? You think these nodules are something else? Because you've said that gurgling sounds are present on pressing, so I would want to know that with gurgling sounds, if you get hard nodules, what are the possibilities? And more so on the left-sided growth. One is that you said it could be growth itself, say with a nodular mass and plus adherent bowel loops more with it.
Yes, ma'am.
But then other than that, more common is a stricturizing growth on the left side, and the lump that you feel may be all because of collected hard fecal matter.
Yes,
so what we could have done here could have been, we could have done indentability test.
Yes, there was no
There was indentability, you would have known that
fecal
this
matter.
Was, all these nodules were probably because of impacted fecal matter there. Yeah. So now we're not clear about what we are dealing with. Is it a large lump that we are dealing with, or is it a stricturizing growth with collected fecal matter there?
Yes, ma'am.
Right? So
yes,
we have to keep these possibilities in mind. Yes. So
how would you know it's a fecal matter?
So fecal matter is indentable. This is a doughy fecal.
Indentable.
Indentable, sir.
Not intendable.
Indentable.
Indentable.
Sir.
And this lump is occupying which region?
Sir, it is occupying the left iliac fossa and hypogastrium, extending into the hypogastrium.
The lumbar area is all free. Can you show us the picture? Now you're putting your finger right across, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Now the lump is here.
Yes, sir. So this is the margin.
See, just be careful about it. I am not saying for any other reason. With the same pointer, please draw the quadrants quickly.
Sir. Sir, we'll make two horizontal lines.
And draw this one.
Sir.
It's transtubercular, no?
Transtubercular line, 2 centimeters behind the ASI.
So go right straight. So it will be going into the lumbar region very often.
Sir.
I am not saying it for any reason. Even if you had not shown me the picture, I would have asked you this question. Because I know these are some areas which are not so big. It's very similar to the right hypochondrial lump yesterday. They never... Lumps won't get confined to hypochondrium because they usually will cross. It's a small area. So be careful in describing it.
Sir.
So it is a left iliac fossa along with lumbar region.
Lumbar region and hypogastrium.
And yes, of course, hypogastrium. So be clear on this. Don't miss out. Although it's not going too far laterally, so that's fine. Is it a mobile lump?
Yes, it's a mobile lump.
What is the axis of mobility?
Sir, it is...
You have the pointer. You can show us.
It will move in this direction, sir.
Will, did it? Was it mobile in that direction or you are saying it will move in that direction?
Sir, it was mobile in slightly oblique horizontal direction, sir.
You mentioned that?
No, sir.
Okay. Why is that important?
Sir, it will give us an indication regarding the organ of origin.
Okay, one. And would it also tell you whether it's retroperitoneal or intraperitoneal?
The retroperitoneal lump will not come forward, sir. It would stay in the...
No, I was trying to help you that you... If it is mobile, it's more likely to be intraperitoneal.
Yes, sir.
Retroperitoneal lumps would be fixed.
Yes, sir.
In these areas, whether it is iliac fossa, lumbar region or hypogastrium, be very clear on whether it's intraperitoneal or retroperitoneal because there is no movement on respiration that you notice here. So then mobility is the feature.
Yes, sir.
Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
It's a mobile lump, so that rules out a retroperitoneal lump. What is the possible retroperitoneal lump here that you may get?
Sir, any swelling in the left kidney on the lower pole?
Lower kidney is much higher. Next.
A retroperitoneal sarcoma in this.
Any retroperitoneal lymph nodes.
Lymph nodes.
And malignancies. I just wanted to shift so that I wanted to check whether you are alert to anything else or what you have already decided to discuss.
Yes.
So first thing in any lump in the abdomen, like yesterday we checked it with a couple of people, you should be able to clearly say it is intra-abdominal and number two, whether it's intraperitoneal or retroperitoneal. In what way you say it is entirely your take. Mobile.
Yes, sir.
In upper part, moving on respiration. You don't have to do knee elbow anyway. Nobody does knee elbow. Shift test to be done. The same thing could be on the right side. So if you have, it can be a mirror image. So we may not have the right iliac fossa lump discussion today. We will focus on left only. Now, if you can describe the lump optimally, then things are done.
Sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
Why do you think it is a sigmoid?
Sir, the lump is points from the history that support my diagnosis are alterations in the bowel habit, presence of mucus in the stools.
How old is your patient?
So my patient is 40 years old, sir.
Younger side?
Younger side.
Okay.
But then he has a history of possibly a positive family history of similar...
There is a family history. Okay. And?
Any absence of any urological symptoms can rule out a renal lump or a urological lump from a...
Now in your examination, something very important is missing. Any lump in the iliac fossa, what is the additional examination that you need to do?
Sir, neurovascular, I should have checked for the neurovascular
test. Lower limb.
Yes, lower limb, sir.
Why is it necessary? Necessary means why is it mandatory?
Sir, it can be impinging upon the nerves and thereby precipitating as any neurovascular deficit.
Would it help to know the movements of the hip joint?
Yes, sir. If we can find out if it is impinging over the joint or not, sir.
No. What is the most common cause of an iliac fossa swelling with fixed flexion deformity?
Sir, left-sided Schwann abscess.
So, that is why it is necessary. So, movements at the hip joint, any neurovascular deficit in the lower limb, they are mandatory and they should be described. Similarly, examination of the spine is mandatory. Because with Schwann abscess or abscess in the front, you can have a problem in the spine also. So, therefore, examination would not be just focused on what you already decided. Be very careful about it. A classical left iliac fossa lump, right iliac fossa lump, lower limb examination, spine examination. So, therefore, what have we done? We have made examination of spine mandatory in abdomen. Examination of the Virchow's node mandatory in abdomen because it's a part of the disease.
Yes, sir.
And you need to look for it.
Yes,
sir. What was your finding on DRE?
Sir, there was presence of blood and fecal tinge. And
you mentioned there was no growth.
No growth, sir.
What else?
And at that point when I did, there was no blood tinge. There was fecal soiling and mucus soiling, sir. And there were no deposits in cul-de-sac. In the
rectovesical pouch. Yes, huh? All right. And you said there is free fluid in the abdomen.
Yes, sir.
How did you check for free fluid? This is a picture.
Yes.
Show it with a pointer.
Sir, in this I did a fluid thrill test. In this we start...
You did fluid thrill test.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir.
Carry on.
Fluid thrill was negative in this case. So, we proceeded.
So, first you wanted to see whether the vessel is completely full.
Sir, I am sorry, sir. Sir, I started with shifted dullness test, whereby I started percussing from Ziffy sternum to downwards. And where I received...
Downwards where? Just show me.
Sir, from Ziffy sternum to downwards in the midline.
Okay.
And where we received a tympanic note, we started percussing towards laterally.
Which way you went laterally?
Sir, towards the right side. And wherever we dull note came, I made the patient...
No, I am not going further. First of all, start your pointer at the Ziffy sternum. And we keep going down to the symphysis pubis. This is for two reasons. To exclude a lump in the midline.
Yes, sir.
And also to find out the point of maximum resonance. So that you can use that as a reference point.
Yes, sir.
And then you go laterally. Not in the direction where the lump is.
Yes, opposite side.
So you go to the opposite side. But don't go too far laterally because you'll find it dull, muscles are there. So up to the mid-clavicular line and just about lateral to it.
Yes, sir.
If you find a dull node, then you tilt the patient. Wait for 15 to 20 seconds, percuss at the same place. Don't remove your finger. If it is resonant and it was dull earlier, it is shifting dullness. And you don't have both of them present in the same patient naturally. Because you need more fluid for fluid thrill.
Fluid thrill.
So it will all be full. So there will be no place to shift. So therefore to say I checked for fluid thrill first would invite, I mean it's a very basic simple test to do. And the note on that lump would be dull and that's not fluid. So is there any fluid present, any sign on inspection which makes you think it's fluid?
So umbilicus is transversely stretched, so that's why.
Yes. Why did you say patient has got intestinal obstruction?
So for the last 5 days, patient has not been able to pass flatus in stools.
That is symptomatic.
Yes, sir.
But this is a known patient with constipation. She's got a history of constipation. No?
Yes, sir.
So how would you...
Change in character of the pain as well, sir. The pain has become more diffused, present and increased in intensity for the last 5 days.
No, what is the triad of intestinal obstruction that you look for in anybody?
Sir, pain abdomen with distension. There is
vomiting.
And
does he have that?
Yes, sir.
He has distension?
Yes, sir, he has distension, sir. I mentioned the examination findings, sir.
No, you did mention it, but you're saying it's because of fluid. Is it gaseous?
Sir, it was, partly it was gaseous, sir.
Do you think it is a distended abdomen of intestinal obstruction? I am asking you. How are the bowel sounds in this patient?
Exaggerated, sir.
They can be exaggerated in a subacute obstruction. They usually have acute and subacute kind of a picture going on.
Yes, sir.
Does he have vomitings?
Yes, sir. He had 2 episodes of vomiting on the preceding day when I took the history.
So be careful with that, because a patient with acute intestinal obstruction will have such a distension that you won't be able to appreciate. It doesn't look like a distended abdomen to me, transversely stretched. What will happen with the gaseous distension to the umbilicus? It will get vertically stretched.
Vertically stretched.
So be careful. You can say with features of subacute kind of an intestinal obstruction, not an acute intestinal obstruction. Anyway, I'll leave it at that. We have, you can go to the last slide now again. I brought you back here. Liver, spleen, kidney there. Go back. Exaggerated bowels on liver. No other palpable lumps. Okay. Let's go to the impression. We have time constraint on this. Go to the last part. Can we move? Diagnosis?
Sir.
With no pressure effects, what is that?
Sir, no pressure effects, no neurovascular deficit, sir.
Two important things I thought I must add here. You showed us the pedal edema, and it would have been nice had you told us if it is one bilateral or not, and if it is more on one side, because you have a left-sided growth in the lower abdomen, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So whether it was asymmetrical on the two sides.
Whether it was a pressure on the vein, which you are saying is no pressure effect, that's why.
Yes, sir.
Is it a bilateral?
Bilateral, sir.
You should mention that.
Sir.
Although you did qualify by saying the patient is malnourished on account of pitting edema. Call it bilateral pitting edema. Because unilateral could be due to pressure, which is what we are expecting you would describe in the iliac fossa lump. I am repeating for the benefit of all the postgraduates. You must describe the lower limb in all patients with iliac fossa lump, right side, left side, to rule out any infiltration or pressure effects on the underlying structures. And then movements at the hip joint to exclude any swaths. Okay. So your diagnosis is sigmoid colon carcinoma. See, carcinoma of the sigmoid colon.
Yes.
What stage?
Sir, M1A.
So you should have described it here. Probably metastatic. Because of?
Presence of a Virchow's node.
Anything else?
Free fluid in the abdomen.
Yeah, so presence of ascites and also Virchow's node. Is that what you want to say?
Yes, sir.
Why do you think it's a carcinoma of the sigmoid colon? You mentioned some points in history and then we stopped you.
Yes, sir.
Any findings on examination?
Sir, the lump was mobile, present because of the location of the lump in the left lower abdomen. Also because of its
lower mobility. Abdomen, it will still remain? It'll in the
in
left iliac fossa, lumbar
fossa
region.
Occupying the also extending up to the lumbar region and the hypogastrium. It was a mobile lump. And they were on pressing, there was a gurgling sound, which suggests it is from etiology.
Looked like a bowel etiology.
Lump, yes,
okay.
Sir.
And madam asked you about the nodularity.
Yes.
Should be able to.
It was not indentable.
Not indentable, plus nodularity can be there in a malignancy itself by virtue of its deposits on the surface. That's important. And in this case, especially patient being having ascites, so they could be peritoneal nodules on omental nodules, everything could be.
Present.
There, no?
Yes,
that's the reason. Any differential diagnosis?
So maybe, as ma'am suggested, a stricture because of which there is a impaction of the fecal matter.
The stricture is benign or malignant?
A benign disease.
Unusual, no? So don't buy it unnecessarily. It's a classical case. And it's a mobile lump which takes away the retroperitoneal etiology. So you're looking at a bowel lump, which is in the left side, in the region of sigmoid. So that falls into place. Don't worry about it.
Large nodular lump, you can, if you want to give a differential diagnosis, you may give GIST also. They happen in the sigmoid areas too. The common is in the upper GI.
Yes,
right. How do you proceed now?
So I would like to conduct the investigations to support my to confirm my diagnosis, to support a diagnosis, and to treat the patient. Sir, since
usually it is confirming the diagnosis, staging the disease. In malignancy, supporting the diagnosis, all right, but staging is important.
The disease, sir.
And then you treat, right? So,
I would like to proceed with the colonoscopy, a visual colonoscopy.
You do a colonoscopy and it is a GIST. Now,
yes,
so what's the blunder you committed? How would you proceed? Let's start with the first verse. and the free fluid. No, no, no. Once you found it, you don't do CT now. You've done an ultrasound first. So you've done an ultrasound and it shows the ascites, it shows the peritoneal deposits. Who is bothered about CT now? You would do what? You need some diagnosis. What will you do for that?
So we'll proceed with colonoscopy.
Now you can proceed with colonoscopy. You don't keep on doing. Would you need a CT if there is metastatic disease?
No, sir.
Okay, so you do an ultrasound and then with the suspicion that it is a malignancy, you put in a colonoscope. एक माइक वहाँ आगे रख दीजिए, किसी को बिठा रही हो, कोई आया तो है नहीं. ओके, सो कोलोनोस्कोपी फॉर व्हाट?
सो कोलोनोस्कोपी टू विजुलाइज वेयर इज द ग्रोथ एंड टू गेट अ बायोप्सी इन फॉर अ फाइनल टिश्यू डायग्नोसिस.
ओके, बट सपोज ऑन अल्ट्रासाउंड इट डजंट लुक लाइक अ मेटास्टेटिक डिजीज, देन यू प्रोसीड
विद डूइंग अ सीटी, सीसीटी एब्डोमेन एंड इन दैट.
बट यू विल स्टिल डू अ कोलोनोस्कोपी फर्स्ट अनलेस यू हैव अ डायग्नोसिस. Why should you invest your time and money into it?
Yes, sir.
So the only way to get a diagnosis is to do a colonoscopy.
Sir.
And in this case, don't just jump to saying colonoscopy. Some examiners might say, now what's the point in doing an ultrasound? Therefore, you should say that it's an extension of your clinical examination only. And you can do an ultrasound to make sure that you're not dealing with a metastatic disease and there is a problem related to that.
Yes.
Now, Rishabh, you take care of the mic. Okay. So you've done a colonoscopy, it's a moderately differentiated carcinoma, adenocarcinoma, and there is ascites. How do you proceed further? Can you do something simpler rather than colonoscopic biopsy in this patient? You've done an ultrasound.
An ultrasound, we can say, look for any presence of...
You've done ultrasound. Looking is over. What next?
So we can proceed with the CCT abdomen and the metastatic workup.
Anybody? Take the mic. Mic, yeah, idhar do, idhar hi hai, aray, idhar hi hai. Achha, tumo.
So we'll take ultrasound guided biopsy from the liver mets if this if it is present.
There are no liver mets here. This is the case.
Or ascitic fluid will be there, though. We'll
so one is ascitic fluid. How much will you require? Stand up and answer. Speak loudly. Take the mic. There's the mic.
Around a liter, 1 liter.
1 liter, why? Why do you need 1 liter?
Because they centrifuge it and look for the...
So you can't do it with 20, 30 ml. And in this patient, can you do something even less invasive? This patient, you've been listening to the history and examination, no?
Yes, sir.
Is there any finding in the neck?
So FNAC, neck.
Ultrasound of the neck and FNAC.
Why do you need it? You have a node there.
FNAC, yes, from the node.
So you do an FNAC from the node to find out a metastatic disease.
Yes, sir.
Is that right?
Yes, sir.
If you find it's adenocarcinoma metastatic, do you need to do anything more?
So
certainly not a CT.
No, sir.
So patient has got any reason for being in surgical ward. You want to treat him surgically?
No, sir. We'll start with him primarily on chemotherapy, sir.
Yes. Patient has got intestinal obstruction and you'll send the patient to medical oncologist.
No, sir, after...
Your
after
diagnosis, I have no problem with anything. Read your diagnosis.
Sir, if it's a case of acute intestinal obstruction...
This is a case.
So we'll have to operate the patient in case of acute intestinal
obstruction. So don't waste time and don't be, lost in your presentation. And for those who are present here, be alert and be awake so that you are able to hear what is happening, record it and answer the question properly. Patient has got left-sided malignancy with intestinal obstruction. Treatment.
So in case of an acute intestinal obstruction?
I have told you the picture.
So we'll have to prepare the patient for OT and do an exploratory laparotomy. And
so don't mess around. There's no point wasting time. Any patient of intestinal obstruction needs to be treated by surgery. What's the gold standard investigation for intestinal obstruction? Question is specific. Postgraduate question. We are not wasting time on where do you look for what. This is not an
X-ray. X-ray abdomen erect.
X-ray abdomen is the gold standard.
So contrast and CT scan.
Contrast and CT scan is the gold standard. But you do before that what? X-ray?
X-ray.
Abdomen. Can you complete it? X-ray abdomen.
X-ray
you do
abdomen,
X-ray.
Erect and supine.
Do you write X-ray abdomen in your prescription?
X-ray abdomen, erect and supine, sir.
So please don't give incomplete answers and irritate the examiner. You're a postgraduate student.
Yes.
Why erect? Why supine?
So erect, we'll be able to see the air fluid levels, and in supine, we can see the dilated bowel loops to show the where is the level of obstruction.
Erect shows you there is obstruction. Supine shows you where is the obstruction. Is that clear? Can you say a loud yes?
Yes,
sir.
Louder.
Yes, sir.
Wake up! You always those drowsy answers irritate. Can you repeat that now? So we'll do an X-ray abdomen, erect.
Erect and supine.
Supine.
Erect we'll do to see.
Why can't you see the level in erect?
So it'll only give us the.
Why can't you see the level in erect? That row, second row. First row. First row is here, no?
Sir, because it's only in supine that the peripheral.
When you stand up, what happens?
So air is, air goes
when you
up.
Stand up, what happens to the bowel?
So it goes down.
It goes in the pelvis. The jejunum, ileum all falls into the pelvis. So you won't be able to appreciate the levels. But you can find out air fluid levels because of the gravity that you'll have to use the gravity to find out. And then also any gas under the dome of diaphragm, any perforation that could have happened following obstruction.
Yes.
Then supine is to see the level. Right? Mango writes two lines there, no? But I'm making it simpler for you. Erect to know.
If there's an obstruction. And
erect to know there is obstruction. Supine to know where
is
obstruction.
The obstruction.
But the gold standard is contrast and CT scan. So you've taken up this patient for surgery. Your findings are correct. There is a sigmoid growth. Would this be large bowel obstruction or small bowel also can be made out?
Yes, sir.
Hmm? And it's a small bowel obstruction. Cecum is collapsed. So
we'll explore to find the where is the.
You opened up.
We'll look by where is if there's an obstruction in the small bowel.
How would it happen?
Sir, if there is the tumor has directly invaded the small bowel and.
Well, the small bowel is involved by the tumor.
Yes, sir.
Which happens very frequently because that's what falls over it.
Yes.
Large bowel obstruction is very late. Okay. And then there can be involvement of all the, like you were discussing about the nodularity of it.
Yes.
You don't know what all is involved, okay? Now how will you, what should you do? You found out the patient has got obstruction, you opened up. This patient is not for a curative resection, no? I hope you agree?
Yes, sir. Only palliative resection can be done here.
So what is that?
Sir, since it's a large bowel obstruction at the level of sigmoid, I can do an end colostomy. With suture closure of the.
No, but small bowel obstruction, why will you do?
The obstruction is small bowel.
Then I'll make an ileostomy, sir.
Proximal you made an ileostomy, okay.
Sir.
And then rest, patient has got ascites also. Anybody?
Resect the tumor and make a mucous fistula. And patient has got ascites, and in an emergency situation, the patient. Will not be able to sustain an anastomosis.
If you do an ileostomy and patient has got a sigmoid growth, what is the risk now?
Sir, it can retract, stoma retraction.
Yes. Patient may land up into closed loop obstruction. Due to ileocecal valve being competent. If it is incompetent, it's all right. You got an obstruction here, and you got an ileocecal valve which is closed. Therefore, that's how came the role of Hartmann's procedure. If you can resect it, you can bring even the colon out. But if it is small bowel obstruction, you need an ileostomy. I'm not denying it. But by and large, either make the valve incompetent. How do you do that? Yesterday we discussed.
So by inserting the little finger and
finger, how will it reach there? Take the mic. One was the Foley's, the other method also we described. Thumb and finger, you can pinch it and break it. I mean, make it incompetent, then it's all right. Otherwise, ileostomy is a bad option. We don't do transverse colostomies these days. Why?
So because
they're not very popular. Yes. They're still done.
So because later on, it will be difficult to do an anastomosis because of a tenuous blood supply in that area.
Anybody? Junaid? Like? What is the complication you're saying? How will it be more with colostomy? Colostomy is always superior to ileostomy in terms of the content that is coming out. Colostomy, you may damage the marginal artery and cause ischemia, and later on you may have to pull it down for anastomosis. Not in this case. Ileostomy is easy to do, easy to close, easy to manage, and we know that the content is not such a problem anymore. So a lot of people would like to do ileostomy, quicker, faster to do, to go back and, you know, the second surgery is also easy, and it's as effective. So there are a lot of people like to do ileostomies now. Earlier days, colostomy was very popular. But the problem was, when you are lifting it up, you may damage the marginal artery of Drummond, which may cause damage, because it's an important vessel, okay? Anything quickly,
so two more minutes. Colostomy only, larger loop is there, so you have a larger stoma, which is more difficult to manage. Foul smell may come any time, so it is not very patient-friendly procedure. And the appearance of the contents is like that of frank fecal matter. So that's why neither the patient nor the doctors prefer it.
Especially in malignancies, you may have to dissect and bring the colon down. It becomes a technically difficult procedure to handle. And then where do you normally... Transverse colostomy is usually in the subcostal space, layer low down, so it is visible. It's not, and as rightly said, the contents, and most colostomies are flush, so retraction is not an issue. It's the content, the smell of it, patient friendliness as rightly brought out, and then subsequent closure. And you achieve the same outcome with ileostomy. The only problem is, especially in the left-sided growths, the blind loop that you may create, which can cause a blowout. It happens, cecal blowouts, I have seen and managed. Don't think ileocecal valve is, ileocecal valve is a very competent valve. Okay. Now, one of these girls can take care of the mic, because you can sit down. Please pass it on to them. Now, how do you proceed in this case? What do you do now?
So after, okay, we like to take the patient to the OT and explore the patient, do a palliative surgery. After doing a palliative surgery, we can send the specimen that we might have resected, if it is resectable.
What is palliative surgery in colorectal cancers? That is also resection.
Resection, yes.
So surgery is?
If it is resectable.
Yes, it should be resected. Resection. Right? And when you find, if you find peritoneal deposits all over, then...
So we'll take a specimen of the peritoneal deposits and also send it for a histopathological examination.
Well, that you will. Would it change your manage, your intent? It'll be more...
So we'll still be doing the resection of the primary tumor, so...
You would not insist on anastomosis.
Anastomosis, yes, sir.
Because it's not likely to succeed. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Can we wind up? Give him a big round of applause. First case, we started on time, and we move on to the next case. I think the next case presented by Junaid. Quickly.